This is the first event sponsored by the Pleasant Hill Middle School Earth Club and also the Leadership Club, the Leadership class who's been working on recycling. We have a really exciting presentation for you. I'm going to start out by introducing Ann Baker, who's with Republic, and she's part of the Green Team, as am I, as Mr. Gallardo. And she's going to introduce the rest of our prestigious people who are in front of you, and we'll go on with them.
My name is Ann Baker. I work for the garbage company, Republic Services. Some of you are familiar to me, part of the Pleasant Hill Education Initiative, which is initiated by Michael Harris, who's one of our city council members. So awesome to have him here today, along with Liz as part of our team too. So we're just trying to green the schools in Pleasant Hill, including you guys. So I think without much further ado, unless you want to say hello, Michael.
Well, I want to thank the Green Team and the folks here at Pleasant Hill Middle for your concern about the environment. It's a very precious resource, and unfortunately, if we don't do something positive to help, when you folks are grown up, it's going to be really a problem. And I hope that you pay close attention to the message that you're hearing this morning, and also please let your parents know how important it is to protect the environment. I'll turn it back to Ann, and thank you all for coming this morning.
Hi guys, I am Barbara from Protect Our Winners, and we're really excited to be here today, so thank you for having us. We are a group of snowboarders, skiers, snow enthusiasts who are coming together to fight climate change. And today we have a very special guest, one of our athletes, Rolf Backstrom. He is one of the best pro snowboarders in the world, and he's going to be talking to you today about why he's involved and how you
today and talk to you a little bit about climate change.
Hey everyone, I'm Gretchen Blyler with Protect Our Winters. A nonprofit that's fighting climate change on behalf of everyone that loves mountains and snow. Today, I'm here to talk to you about something that's really important to me and everyone who spends time in our mountains, stopping the effects of climate change. So why does protecting winter mean so much to me? I've been a professional snowboarder now for the past 13 years. I'm a four-time X Games gold medalist and an Olympic silver medalist. And I've been able to travel around the world year-round chasing snow. And unfortunately, with that, I've seen the effects of climate change firsthand. So not only does my livelihood depend on the snow, but it goes way beyond that. Ever since I was a kid, the experience of just being outdoors has given me a sense of adventure, freedom, and purpose. And I really think that's something that everyone should have a chance to enjoy for themselves. I first joined POW when I realized that climate change was seriously affecting our winter seasons. This means less time on snow for all of us and generations to come. But it also means trouble for the entire winter sports industry and the local communities who make their living when it snows. It's time to end climate change. It's time to take action, but don't just take my word for it. Today, we're gonna hear from top athletes and how they've turned their love for winter into professions. They're gonna give you the quick lowdown on climate change, what it is, what it looks like, how it's affecting us, and what they're doing to help. Most importantly, they'll show you just how crucial your voice and actions can be. Together, we'll kick off a movement that will bring the fight against climate change to the next level.
I grew up in Washington. My parents were really, really friendly and shared their love for the outdoors and for the mountains with me. So I grew up skiing and snowboarding. And I moved down here in 2005 to Squaw Valley. It's up the hill, a few hours away. Love the outdoors and really passionate about protecting it and making sure that it's here for my kids and your kids and for all of us to enjoy.
My name's Angel Collinson. I'm a big mountain skier. Well, the first TGR movie that I ever saw was Tangerine Dream. And it was the first time I remember watching skiing and being so moved and like feeling so passionate about what I was seeing that it just looked so fun. I was like, that's what I want to do.
My name's Lucas Dabari. I'm a professional snowboarder. When I was 18 years old, I won the Mount Baker Bank Slalom. To the snowboarding industry, it's one of the most core, respected events, and being the youngest kid at the time to win that, I think really just set off my career.
My name is Ian McIntosh. I'm a big mountain skier. I mean, at a very young age, seeing my cousins and my family ripping and in magazines just made me want to pursue this lifestyle.
I'm Ingrid Backstrom. I'm a skier. I guess one of the most important things to me is just being outside, enjoying nature, and having a good time with friends and family.
My name is Sage Catabriga-Alosa, and I'm a skier. Probably the mentality and spirit, you know, that I kind of have and bring is, you know, positivity, having a good time, loving life.
My name is Danny Davis. I snowboard for a living. I honestly think I love the mountains because I didn't grow up with them and they're so new to me. I'm still learning so much about them.
My name's Jeremy Jones. I'm a professional snowboarder. I made my dream happen because there was really no backup plan. I was just so into snowboarding that I went through a ton of sacrifices just so I could snowboard every day. And so I didn't care where I was sleeping, what I was eating. If I could snowboard every day, that's all that mattered.
The biggest obstacle I've faced along the way has definitely been breaking my femur. That was by far the hardest thing I've ever had to deal with and go through. Fortunately, I'm so passionate about what I do and I love what I do so much that that was all the motivation I needed to get back to doing it.
Like, it was a far-fetched dream to think that I'd be able to film with TGR. Like, that was a fantasy of mine, you know? And I just put one foot in front of the other and I just did what I was passionate about and wasn't caught up in anything else but just what I loved. And as a kid, like, that's really, really powerful. To have confidence and to, like, really think that that's a possibility to make your dreams come true is too bad it's cliche, but it's so, so true.
A lot of people tend to give up on their dreams when it doesn't happen right away, or when things get tough, or when it seems difficult, but it's powering through that that eventually success will come.
You guys like going out in the outdoors and camping?
Campers? Yeah.
That's one of the most special things to me, is just being out in the wilderness and being away from the city and away from the bustle. Just spending time in the outdoors with my family and really close friends is something that I hold really highly. And I have a lot of friends that work in the ski and snowboard industry, and they depend on snowfall to keep business coming to the area. Squaw Valley, where I live, we've had three really dry winters the past few years, and I've unfortunately seen a lot of my friends move up to Seattle, where they've had more stable winters the past few years.
I care about the environment because every time I'm outside, that's when I feel really alive. It gives us so many things in life, whether it's, you know, being able to be outdoors and enjoy, like, fresh air or where our food comes from.
One of my biggest searches in life is to find contentment. And when I'm in the mountains skinning or hiking or just being out there, I really feel at peace. And that's something that I thrive for now.
When you're out there, they're just awe-inspiring. You know, they're beautiful, they're magical, they're dangerous, they're fun. You can really do anything in the mountains. It's truly Mother Nature's playground.
So I am in Wrangell St. Elias National Park. It's the world's biggest wilderness area, and it's home to some of the biggest mountains in the world. It's breathtaking on so many different levels. High peaks, incredible glaciers and seracs, glacier-fed lakes, big river valleys, tons of wildlife. I mean, it's just in every direction. It's just awe-inspiring.
Being in the mountains for me, it means having freedom. It's this place kind of away from everything, but you feel like you're a part of something bigger.
We get caught up in the day-to-day life and in this kind of urban life, or just even interactions with other people, and to go out and just really just be in the moment in the natural world is unique.
I'm not a person that sits on a couch and watches TV. I am outside playing. It doesn't matter what season it is, it doesn't matter what time of the year it is, I am outdoors and I want to preserve it. I want it to last. I don't want to see it destroyed.
Now, you've heard about our passion for the outdoors, for our sports, and for the environments we play in. But before we hear about why we're so concerned about the changes we're seeing in our mountains, let's check out what climate change really is and what's causing it.
One thing that makes life on Earth possible is a thin layer of gases called the atmosphere. It holds in the air we breathe and protects us from the cold of outer space. When energy in the form of light reaches us from the sun, it streams through the atmosphere, making plants grow and lighting up our days. In addition to light, the sun also delivers heat, which warms the planet. But much of that energy is reflected back towards space. Fortunately, though, the Earth's atmosphere works like a blanket, preventing a lot of heat from escaping. In fact, If the Earth didn't have its atmospheric blanket, its average temperature would be about minus 18 Celsius, or 0 Fahrenheit. Brrr. Thanks to the atmosphere, the Earth's average temperature is a much more livable 15 Celsius, about 59 degrees Fahrenheit. One of the gases in Earth's blanket is called carbon dioxide, or CO2. Carbon dioxide is everywhere on Earth, actually, and it's an important part of Earth's delicate balance of life. It's what animals, including us, exhale after they breathe in oxygen. Plants then use carbon dioxide, along with sunlight, to grow and make more oxygen for us to breathe. A lot of carbon dioxide is also absorbed by the oceans. The carbon dioxide that's left over floats up into the atmosphere and helps form our planet-warming blanket. But there's a problem. Scientists have observed that the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere has been steadily rising over the last 100 years, soaring high above anything the Earth has seen for hundreds of thousands of years. All the plants in the world, as well as the oceans, can absorb all the extra carbon dioxide in the air. So consider this. Have you ever put on too many blankets at night? If you've woken up hot and clammy, then you know how the Earth feels when it has more carbon dioxide than it can handle. Scientists now know that excess carbon dioxide and some other gases in smaller amounts are preventing heat from escaping, and this is warming up the planet. They call it the greenhouse effect. Remember that graph of average temperature rise since 1880? Check out this graph of carbon dioxide levels in the atmosphere since 1880. Now let's look at them both. See how they're rising together? That's because, as carbon dioxide goes up, the temperature does too. They're directly connected. Back in the 18th century, people started burning coal to power a new invention, steam engines. But here's something curious. Ever since steam engines were widely used, starting in about 1850, the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere began to climb. Today it stands at 392 parts per million. Parts per million is a special measurement scientists use. 392 is way more carbon dioxide than we've had for many thousands of years. And the number continues to rise. So where does the extra carbon dioxide come from? You might say it comes from our success. And steam engines were just the start. It comes from our bustling cities and towns, filled with things like cars, planes, factories, office buildings, homes, computers, TVs, air conditioners, and refrigerators. All those inventions were good, and we've accomplished some amazing things because of them. But they all require one thing. Energy. Lots of energy. And it's our thirst for energy that has some unintended consequences for the planet. Where does energy come from? Well, we get most of it from burning things like coal, oil, and natural gas. These are called fossil fuels because they were formed deep in the ground over millions of years by ancient decaying organisms, or fossils. Chances are, most of the things that you do that take energy in a given day are powered by burning coal in a power plant. And of course, you burn gasoline, which comes from oil, when you ride in a car. Meanwhile, many homes and buildings are heated by natural gas. Fossil fuels are full of energy, and they've been useful to us. But there's a problem. Burning them releases carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. In 2009, each person in the United States used enough fossil fuel energy to release an average of 17 tons of carbon dioxide. That's about the equivalent of 4 African elephants. Over time, all of that carbon dioxide really starts to add up. And because of the thickening blanket that causes the greenhouse effect, the more carbon dioxide there is, the higher Earth's average temperature goes. Scientists and the governments of many nations now agree that we're releasing too much carbon dioxide. And to prevent the worst effects of rapid climate change, we're going to have to reduce that 392 parts per million number to about 350. Fortunately, by making good choices now, we can tackle the problem of too much carbon dioxide. And in case you didn't know, you can be part of the solution too.
So I've traveled all over the world to snowboard. I've seen some really cool places. I've also experienced some really, really weird weather patterns. You know, one of the effects of climate change is crazy weather. So last spring I was in Greenland and I was about 10 miles from the Arctic Circle, and it was raining on us. And that was really, really scary for me, being so close to the Arctic Circle, and it's supposed to be, you know, near freezing, near 0 degrees. But more recently and closer to home, when we have dry winters like we have in Tahoe the past three seasons, there's not as much moisture in the soil and the trees get really dry and brittle. And right now there is a fire that is 92,000 acres. It's actually bigger than Lake Tahoe itself. And that is just 5 miles from where I live. So as soon as I'm done with the assembly here, I'm gonna drive home and make sure that my house doesn't burn down, or at least move the stuff out. So that's a really, really important effect that climate change has, is that not as much moisture in the soil.
That's a pretty good picture of what's happening to our planet. Isn't it crazy to think that some people still deny that climate change is even happening? 97% of all scientists agree that climate change is human-caused. And there's no arguing with firsthand experience. Just ask any winter sports athlete. We're seeing it every day.
In my short little lifespan, I've seen drastic change. I can see that storms are getting more drastic and crazier. I can see when I go to Alaska every year that the glaciers are shrinking faster and faster every year. You know, you look at old photos from 100 years ago, what the glaciers used to look like up there versus what they look like now, and how much of that has been in the last 20 years is insane, and it's scary.
Glaciers in Chamonix have been really well documented because they've been living amongst those glaciers for a long time. And you can see exactly where they were 100 years ago, 50 years ago, 10 years ago, 5 years ago, and even last year. The glaciers are receding at a rate in Europe where it's, you see a year in and year out a difference. And adding up all these record weather events, that's when I start shaking my head, when it's like rain in January, snow in June, the coldest temperatures on record, the warmest temperatures on record, the biggest snowfall ever recorded, the longest drought ever recorded, the least amount of snow ever recorded. All those things have happened in the last 3 years where I live.
This past year in Tahoe, where I live, in Squaw Valley, the winter was lower than any people had experienced in so many years, and now the lake is lower. There's so many things that are affected because of that, the wildflowers, the crops, everything. And not only that, but people's livelihoods who live in the mountain community and depend on that winter tourism.
One of my biggest realizations that climate change is real and is really happening is not just the decreased snowfall in Utah lately, you know, in the past 15 years or so, but also in the forest fires. We haven't been getting as much snowfall or as much consequentially spring runoff, and it's been a lot drier, and we've had like tons of forest fires the past few years in Utah, and the air quality is terrible because of that, and it makes you feel like it's really, really real. You can see it happening.
So what does this mean? Well, first, our snow is in jeopardy, and that means less time on the mountains for all of us. And for mountain economies that depend on winter, when ski resorts close for good, that means a lot of other businesses will too. Fewer jobs for us, for our friends, and for our families. Scientists say that in 50 years, the climate in Colorado could be like Texas's today. The lower snowfalls and earlier spring thaws are causing us to lose the fresh water that is stored in a healthy snowpack. Add in dry winters and hotter summers, and you get wildfires that threaten our homes and wipe out our forests. Farmers are losing their ability to irrigate their crops, and cities are facing water shortages.
So there are a lot of things we can all do to help reverse the effects of climate change. So many of them have positive effects on your life. One of the ones I really like to do is riding my bike instead of driving a car or walking. Walking's fine, but riding a bike is a great thing you can do to reduce your carbon footprint, and it's great exercise as well. Always good to be outdoors.
I think I was first interested in climate change when I was growing up at Snowbird Ski Resort, and I really noticed a difference as I grew up, and also looking at old photos where we're just not getting as much snow as we used to, and it's been trending that way consistently.
Winter would just maybe be non-existent for a couple months in certain places, and that was really eye-opening.
I live in Washington. I ride Mount Baker. The elevation of the top lift is 5,000 feet. When it gets a little warmer, we see the effects right away. It was so apparent to me that something needed to be done.
Every year I go out in the mountains, I see that the glaciers are a little bit smaller. I know that that's where my water comes from. I know that that's where the planet's water comes from. And to see that disappearing, it's a scary thought.
What's happening is exactly what these scientists told us would happen with climate change, is more erratic weather events and more serious weather events. And we're living it now. This isn't a prediction for the future. This is now.
I think that young people should get involved in this debate on climate change because we can make a difference, you know? And we're just starting our life here on Earth, and we're gonna be seeing big changes, and maybe in negative ways if we don't say anything about it, you know? And
it's really up to future generations to make that change. We need change, and we need it now.
If we can get them on the right track and teach them what we've learned about climate change and the environment, they'll be that much more set up to push it even farther and go even greener and be even more self-reliant and sustainable. So essentially, if we can build them a little bit of a platform to start on, they're gonna be way ahead of where we can ever get in our lifetime.
Young people have the most to gain and the most to lose from taking care of the Earth and dealing with climate change right now. To be empowered by taking care of your environment, you can actually influence adults, and influence your parents, and influence the people you know by setting a good example and being aware and being informed of what's going on. So
here we are. We all know that climate change is happening, and you've heard from all of us who are seeing it firsthand. That's not a world we or future generations want to live in. It's real, and it's a problem we all have to deal with now, and it's already affecting you and me.
Today, not much is happening to solve it, even though we know it's a really big deal.
For too long, people have either denied it, ignored it, done nothing about it, and just hoped that it's gonna go away.
Unfortunately, you're gonna be the ones left with this problem and the ones to solve it.
Oftentimes it's overwhelming and people feel like they won't make a difference or, oh, it's just this one thing, it's not gonna matter. But if we all start to do every little tiny thing, it all adds up.
Whether it's like turning off the water, turning off the light switches, or unplugging your cell phone charger.
Riding my bike, carpooling, using reusable bags, using reusable water bottles.
I buy local. I have all my light bulbs in my house and fluorescents, and so they're low energy. We have an on-demand water heater.
Becoming more educated, especially come election time, what's at stake.
Really paying attention to who we vote for and getting behind people who are voting for the environment.
Little things add up and make a huge difference, and they're not really that hard to change in your everyday life.
We can start to make a difference by doing just one thing at a time. Whether it's using less electricity and water, recycling, riding your bike, or carpooling, the little things matter. And so does speaking up and teaming up. You're the generation that's in the driver's seat, so make your influence heard. You guys are all in this together and are the ones that are going to fix this problem. Start a recycling program, send around petitions, work to get your school on solar. Throughout the year, we'll ask you to do some fun but important things with us that will make a difference.
It's like we're fighting climate change. We need you to get involved too. You're activists just like us.
Close your eyes and visualize the world you want to live in.
We can't wait for others to solve it. It's our time. Our time is now.
First, get outside and appreciate what you need to protect.
You need to take this thing over. Lead us down a different path. We need to fight for it.
It's up to us.
It's this generation.
Please take on climate change with me.
Every one of you can make this happen. You just have to be willing to stand up and say something.
People all around the world are taking a stand.
Get others on board.
It is up to us to stand up and force people to listen.
Badge yourself. Be a leader.
We gotta tackle this thing together.
If you stay involved, maybe we'll even ride together.
make your own videos.
Grab stickers, get our social media buttons, links to our videos, etc.
Our time is now.
Our time is now.
Our time is now.
Our time is now.
You are the future leaders. We need you to get involved.
Demand action.
Join me.
Join me.
Join us.
Join us.
Join us.
Join us. It's easy.
Can we count you in?
Thank you so much for being here, Ralph. Where was your home mountain?
I grew up skiing at Crystal Mountain in Washington and started snowboarding when I was 11. Went to college in Bellingham and rode Mount Baker.
Woohoo!
And now I live in Squaw Valley and I've lived there 9 years and snowboard there.
Cool. How did you get involved in this organization?
I'm a friend of Jeremy Jones's who founded Protect Our Winners, and they had a Hot Planet Cool Athletes assembly in the Tahoe area, and they needed an athlete to show up, and I said I would love to be a part of it. A few highlights of my professional career. In 2013, I won the Freeride World Tour, so I'm a world champion free rider.
Congratulations.
Thank you. And then I've been doing a little stunt doubling for a Hollywood movie coming out next year. Some of the travel I've gotten to do, going to Antarctica was a really cool experience. Going to Japan, cool trips in Alaska, I spent 10 days in Greenland last year, and that was really, really special. There are so many small things you can do that have a positive effect on both carbon emissions and have a benefit in your wallet or for your body. I like to use less electricity and then I now have more money in my pocket.
Good point.
Or biking or walking or running somewhere instead of driving. Save more gas and also get exercise.
How can somebody watching this get involved?
You can go to protectourwinners.org and get involved with Protect Our Winners, become a member. You can also do things to reduce your own carbon footprint. Turn the lights off when you're not in the room. Drive less, carpool more. I see so many cars on the highway with only one person in them.
Ralph, thank you for being here today.
Thanks so much for having me here.